From day one in my graduate school, I've heard the ongoing discussion about academia versus industry. Industry usually means pharma and biotech for PhDs in biochemical and medical fields. Today, I'd like to discuss a variety of career paths in pharma and biotech. Welcome to my YouTube channel, my name is Zhu. I'm a PhD in neuroscience turned machine learning engineer. My first interaction with pharma was a visit to Pfizer during my summer exchange program at the University of Michigan in 2010. I had a very basic idea what pharma was. They make drugs. During graduate school, I started to learn more about drug discovery and development and healthcare industry through courses taken in my home department in biology and business school. I did several pro bono due diligence projects in drug development and medical devices. Over time, I accumulated knowledge in drug R&D cycle, clinical trials, FDA, different regulations for food and drug, medical devices, and so on. It was an interesting career path for me, but after talking with people working in pharma and biotech, I realized that I didn't stand a good chance of getting a job in the field. First, my research background was not closely related to clinical study or disease models. Most R&D job opportunities in industry are looking for candidates with either specific technical expertise such as biochemistry, structural biology, or relevant experience in disease models. My technical expertise was in imaging and its application in biology, and it was not readily useful for pharma. Second, the job market in industry is getting very competitive. There are job opportunities in microscope companies such as Bruker and Zeiss that is more relevant to my research background. Indeed, one of my previous lab mates does get a job there. But the competition is fierce. Experienced postdoc researchers and new grad PhDs are competing for the same position. And now even pharma and biotech started to look at applicants' publications, and they prefer postdocs with years of experience. This means new PhD grads may still have to work as postdocs for several years in order to accumulate experience and publications. Because of my lack of relevant research experience in clinical studies, I crossed out industry from my list. In preparation for this video, I talked with 6 PhDs who are working in pharma and biotech and asked how they get started with their career in this field. Let's get started. The first person has 20 years of experience as a senior research associate and was a core facility director at a top university. She left academia and joined a pharma company as a director. Let's call her Mary for anonymity. Mary said her training and experience in academic research encouraged the success of the individual far more than the success of the team. This mentality does not prepare someone for pharma when everything is team-focused. Academic research also survives in a world of small sample size, N equals 3 if you're lucky. Due to the cost and the nature of discovery research, one tends to only do the minimal number of experiments in order to make a claim. In drug manufacturing and production, it is essential and critical to make the drug product in a robust, consistent, and scalable manner. You need a lot more than N equals 3 to get a product that can go into a person. The work relationship and group dynamics in industry is quite different from academia. Each person in pharma has a role in a team, and it works much like a pipeline, with the product being further processed as it gets handed off. You are expected to collaborate well with others and communicate early and often. It is important to be a great communicator and deal with conflicts gracefully. People in academia can be quite opinionated and straightforward when talking about scientific topics they're curious about. But corporate culture tends to be more subtle, goal-driven, and conservative. There are usually 2 tracks, research and management. Although Mary has 20 years of research experience that included managing large academia labs, she still found it difficult to get into a management role in big pharma. Promotion in both tracks can be slow, and sometimes you cannot get promoted unless the person above you leaves or gets promoted first. She recently joined a small but well-established biotech company for the opportunity to have a hybrid process development and management role. Biotech companies tend to let you spread further out of your lane, and she likes it. It feels more like a good melding of her research and pharma worlds. The second person used to work as a researcher in a big pharma after getting her PhD. Let's call her Helen for anonymity. Helen said she always wanted to work on research projects that could be translated to clinical application. So she chose her PhD lab to study the genomics and bioinformatics in leukemia. She decided to apply for jobs in industry at the end of her PhD and talk with her PhD advisor about her plan. She said, "You should not keep your career plan from your PhD advisor because at the end of the day, your future employer will contact your advisor for a reference." She applied for jobs mostly by herself online and said most employers preferred postdocs with more experience to fresh PhDs. She got her job as a fresh PhD mostly because her research background and experience matched this position perfectly. She said publication is not very important as long as you have relevant experience. In pharma, there are a lot of cross-functional teams with people in different fields. In the lab, you can assume people you talk with have a shared language and background. But in pharma, oftentimes, you are interacting with people outside your field. Her work was in preclinical research looking for drug targets, and she worked with people from different backgrounds and learned to communicate her discovery clearly to others. Helen suggests that PhD students in school can learn to communicate and share their research with people in other fields. Job security in big pharma is usually quite good. Promotion can be slow and it usually takes 3 to 5 years to get a promotion. Each promotion usually comes with a 20% salary raise. It is very easy to change jobs as you get more experience, and the tenure for most people is about 2 to 3 years. Helen mentioned job opportunities in pharma and biotech is location dependent. Boston and California has much more job opportunities than New York City. Recently, Helen joined a university in China as a director in a bioinformatics core facility. The third person is working in a biotech company in California. Let's call her Emma for anonymity. She studied structural biology and protein engineering in her PhD. About half of her lab mates have gone to industry. At the end of her PhD, Emma started to look for jobs in industry and applied for relevant positions on LinkedIn and Indeed, but barely got any response. It was because most industry jobs prefer people with some postdoc or industry experience. Finally, she got a phone interview with her later employer, and they found her background matched this position very well. After the phone interview, Emma had not heard from this company for months. Meanwhile, she did her PhD thesis defense. After defense, she contacted HR and asked about her application status. She had another round of interviews with a hiring manager and HR, and then was invited for an on-site interview. She gave a seminar about her PhD research, talked with the cross-functional team members, and later got an offer as a researcher. Her team is on the R&D side of this small biotech, responsible for protein production. The protein they developed is then used by other teams to develop antibodies and small molecule drugs, study signaling pathway and pathological effects. The job duty is very similar to what she did during her PhD. From this job, Emma learned about drug manufacturing process and how to interface and collaborate with other functional groups. She also improved her communication skills and learned to explain her work to others better. What she likes about this job are, first, stable. The company needs her job to move on with their core business, and they may not lay off people easily. Second, the work content is familiar to her, and she's confident in her skills and knowledge. Third, slightly better compensation compared to academia. The work-life balance is great with an 8-hour working day. And if the company goes public, there is additional compensation such as stock options. Emma also has some concerns about her job. The career growth is slow, and she does not get to learn a lot of new things. She still has to do bench work in the lab, even during the pandemic. She is now thinking about changing to a job that allows her to work remotely. The fourth person is working in a biotech in New York. Let's call her Sophie for anonymity. Sophie's PhD research background was in chemical biology, and she initially wanted to look for biological positions in pharma and biotech. She soon realized that competition was fierce for biological positions with a lot of experienced postdoc applicants. Companies prefer postdocs with more experience to fresh PhDs. She also realized that she didn't want to continue doing bench work. She learned about her current employer, a computer-aided drug design company, at a conference. And then she reached out to a previous life mate working in this company for referral. She used the software developed by this company during her PhD and had a strong background in chemical biology and biochemistry. She passed her interviews and got the offer. Sophie said she chose her career path very carefully. During her PhD, she explored various career paths, including consulting, postdoc, biotech, and pharma. She took several MBA courses at Columbia Business School on drug development and healthcare. She said taking MBA courses made her more confident and comfortable talking with the business people. She applied for consulting positions and got an interview from a famous consulting firm. But at that time, she already got an offer from her current employer, so she didn't go further with consulting. She also interviewed for postdoc positions, but realized that she didn't want to spend another 4 to 5 years for an uncertain future. Sophie said she really likes her academic training and experience in computational chemistry. What Sophie likes about her current job are, first, drug discovery is meaningful and helpful for the well-being of people. Second, the culture and work-life balance is great. She sees a lot of female leaders at higher executive positions in her company, and the environment is family-friendly to both male and female employees. Third, the computer-aided drug design industry is developing very fast, and it can be a lifelong career. People with more experience are more valuable. Fourth, before her company went public, she was a bit concerned about her compensation. It is not because her salary is low for her field, it is because she's in New York City, surrounded by high-income people in finance and tech. Now that her company goes public, she's feeling much better. Sophie does not have anything negative to say about her job. She does think about the future of this industry and her career growth very often. The fifth person is working for a pharma company as a regulatory affairs professional. Let's call him Joe for anonymity. Joe's daily job involves strategizing regulatory plans, engaging with health authorities globally, such as FDA in the United States, and securing approvals for various applications from before the start of clinical trials and all the way to the end of the product lives. He collaborated closely with colleagues globally and from other functions. Joe is a life scientist by training and did his thesis primarily in the field of biophysics and biochemistry. As I said in the beginning, PhDs without relevant experience in life science may find it more difficult to launch a job in pharma. So how did Joe get started? While working on his thesis day and night, he became interestingly interested in the drug development process and industry. So he started paying more attention to non-academia career paths for PhD students. By chance, he learned about the regulatory affairs and came across a friend who was a regulatory affairs manager. Through this friend, he learned that there were internship programs out there open to PhD students. Naturally, he filed an application when recruitment began. Based on his observation, these internship programs often attracted more candidates from pharmacy schools than PhD or master students. He tailored his resume to emphasize his cross-disciplinary research background, his personal background in multicultural communication and international environment, and his fast learning ability. He passed the resume screening, and during the interview, among other questions, he was asked specifically about drug development cycle. How did you know all these FDA regulations and principles without any experience? I asked Joe. He told me that he educated himself from FDA's official website, from reading about this career path, and from talking with people in the field. Luckily, he was admitted to this internship program and later offered an opportunity to work full-time as a regulatory affairs manager. Communication is very important for this job, both in verbal and written format. He's very happy and content with his job, which allows him to build a broad and long-term mindset instead of focusing on a very specialized field. In terms of career development, Joe said as you go to a higher level, you'll be managing more complex projects and markets. Also, you'll be leading a team as a people manager. In addition to new grads, regulatory affairs professionals are recruited or transferred internally from other functions in pharma. For example, scientists who are in close collaboration with regulators could potentially work in regulatory affairs. Depending on the area of practice, their work contents are often confidential. There are not a lot of opportunities to get hands-on experience before entering the field. Very often, people learn on the job. So for new grads, a good way to get started is through internship. The sixth and last person is Dr. Tracy Wang. She's working in a pharma company as the Director of Market Access. While R&D focuses on the starting point in the drug lifecycle, market access is the opposite end in the drug lifecycle, making sure there's no barrier for patients to receive a drug. Tracy's team comes up with strategies and approaches and puts together marketing materials to communicate the value that the drugs provide to patients, to their stakeholders in market access, including insurance companies, pharmacies, hospitals, and physicians. After her PhD, she joined a life science consulting company. By chance, she was assigned to work in market access for her first consulting project, which kickstarted her spending 5 years in consulting focused on market access. After consulting, she was curious to see what things were like on the client side. So she made a transition to flip over to work in pharma on market access. While Tracy loved consulting and the diversity of projects, she also acknowledged that consulting was hard and the hours were very long. There is more upward growth opportunity in consulting with the potential for faster promotions with better compensation compared to pharma. However, there is much better work-life balance in pharma, and she had to take a pay cut moving from consulting to pharma. How can the PhD get to where you are now? I asked Tracy. She said, although her role can be filled by PhDs, it is unusual for a fresh PhD to go directly from graduate school to the business side of pharma, because these positions look for industry experience and knowledge. A common route is through consulting or internal transfer from the R&D side to the business side inside the company. Tracy mentioned 4 top skills required for business positions, both in consulting and pharma. First, communication. Second, storytelling. When you work with people on different teams, it is important to convince them why something is important in a clear way. Telling a good story can help others understand an impact of the project. Third, teamworking. Make sure people see you as a person they feel comfortable working with and asking for help. Coworkers and clients all have different personalities, and being able to work with different types of people is very critical. Fourth, strategic and forward thinking. Being able to see both the big picture and details. She said one common struggle for PhDs is that PhDs are too much in the weed and get too comprehensive too early, without thinking about what is the most important for the clients, how to prioritize and identify critical issues, and what not to pay attention to. To improve their skills at graduate school, Tracy suggested to get more involved in extracurricular activities, such as student groups. It's a great source to practice business mindsets with limited resources and budget, and a strong need to prioritize. You'll also work with different people from other backgrounds and learn to become a better communicator and team worker. Tracy and I used to work together as the co-presidents of Women in Science and Columbia, and she credits this as a key experience that helped her prepare for consulting and business. If you find these stories helpful, click the like button below and don't forget to subscribe. In the next video, I'll be talking about my career exploration and scientific communication. See you next time.